word says, taste and see that the Lord is good. You know how many people have never tasted the God's presence? What a shame. There are people that even go to church and still don't taste God's presence. Because there's something that we have to do. Yield. Submit. Praise. Have a desire to want to know more. There must be a will and desire to want to know more of Him. Without a will and desire, we're nothing. If you don't have a desire to know Him, you're not His. Does everybody get it? Well, I haven't had a desire to know Him in years. Well, then you're not His. Because only those that are His have a desire to want to know Him. Oh, John chapter 10. Glory. That'd be a bummer to stand before Him when He says, "Who are you?" Well, you know me. I'm the one that, you know, accepted you years ago, and well, you never had a desire to follow me, so I don't know you. Depart. What a terrible thing. John chapter 10 and verse 7. Would you read it with me, please? Then Jesus said to them again, "Most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. And whoever came before me are thieves and robbers. But the sheep did not what? Hear them." He didn't what? So those who are His don't hear. They may hear, but they don't obey the voice of the stranger. They're no longer influenced, because if you have a desire, a willing desire to know Him, then you want to know His voice. And every other voice, you will begin to reject. Glory. Verse 9, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go out and find" what? "Pasture. The thief does not come except to" what? "Steal, kill, and destroy." That is a fruit that everyone must know. Because if stealing, killing, and destroying is going on in your life, a thief is there. Jesus said, "I've come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly." "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But the hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling." In other words, he does it for money. "And does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them I also will bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore, my Father loves me because I lay down my life that I may take it again." That's a key. That's a key. Highlight it. "No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself." In other words, I have a choice to lay down my life. Everyone say, "I have a choice to lay down my life or to pick it back up." "I have power to lay it down and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. Therefore, there was division again among the Jews because of these sayings. And many of them said, 'He has a demon and is mad. Why do you listen to him?' Others said, 'These are not the words of one who has a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?'" This is so powerful. Jesus brings life abundantly. In other words, the riches of knowing him with no fear but complete trust. Amen? But the enemy has sent false shepherds and wolves in sheep clothing. Satan does this. Does everybody understand? Why? Because he comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and to bring torment. But Jesus gives us a key. Why? Because in this, sight comes. He comes to bring sight. So he says, okay, but you have a choice to maintain your sight. You must constantly lay down your life. Because you have a choice to lay down your life. The more you lay down your life, the more you will see. When you pick your life back up, you become blind. Is everybody okay? In other words, there's a transformation process to a transfiguration. Oh. What's he trying to do? Transform us to what? There's that process that he's transforming me and you so that we can be transfigured. We choose to lay down our lives. Again, demons blind us. The Spirit of God opens our eyes to see. Verse 22. Here's another key. Now it was the feast of dedication. In other words, dedicating yourself should be an everyday moment. I dedicate myself to you. That's how you start your day. You can't warfare without dedicating. If you warfare before dedicating, it's out of order. Now it was the Feast of Dedication in Jerusalem, and it was winter, and Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. Then the Jews surrounded him and said to him, "How long do you keep us in doubt? If you are the Christ, the eternal presence and truth of God Almighty, the Savior, the one who's come to redeem us, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. Do you not believe? Because you are not of what? My sheep." And what's the word believe mean? Follow. "But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. As I said to you, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. And I give them what? Eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand." If they do what? If they follow. Why? Because then they're under his covering. "My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand." Why? Because I and my Father are what? One. The Feast of Dedication, that's an area where you dedicate your life to the Lord. These are those who follow. They are covered. They cannot be taken away. Only those that are not covered are taken away. They can be snatched. Why? Because they're choosing not to lay down their life every moment, every day. And what happens? They become blind. Romans 12. This is called the transformation process. Is everybody there? Verse 1. Let's speak it. "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you what? Present your bodies a living sacrifice." Is that dedication? Yes. "Holy, acceptable to God, which is your responsibility, a reasonable service." So every morning, as you come to the Lord and you repent and you so forth, you dedicate your spirit, soul, and body and possessions to him every morning. Why? Because they're not yours anyways. When you think it's yours, you lose it. Oh, glory. You ready for verse 2? "And do not be what? Conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Ooh. See, so we don't want to stay conformed to this world, but we want to be transformed by the new way of thinking, not as a human, but as a new creation, joint heirs of Christ from the eternal realm to overcome all hindrances in this realm. Is everybody with me? Why? Because hindrances in this realm prevent or even delay your transformation. Why? Because we want to be transformed quickly, constantly. You know, did you ever hear the saying, you know, when I was growing up, I remember they used to have this saying about people that smoked, it stunt their growth. Amen? Well, sin stunts people's growth. Unclean things stunt people's growth. We want to be transformed. So there is a process of transformation. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. One of the things it's going to take is endurance. It's amazing how people stand in line for food or money. Boy, they'll fight. Of course, when we're out there, I mean, to get money, they'll do anything. To get food, they'll do anything. To hunt the opposite sex, they'll do anything. This is carnalites, humanites. When I was in the world, I would do anything to get high. In fact, I took so many risks, ended up in jail, lost my life, lost my wife, lost everything. Was willing to die and go to prison forever to get high. That's pretty sick. Because that's what the devil does. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But it's amazing that when the Holy Spirit is trying to bring us into a place of transformation, we only allow him so much to transform us. Then we say, that's enough. That's called no more growth. When you say, no, that's enough, he backs off. And you'll stay at that level until you die. You will not advance. Is everybody okay? Amen. This is reality. How much are you willing to endure? How much are you willing to press into God's presence to change? Or do you just give up? Well, I guess it is. That's why we must press in. You know, by pressing in, that means you must deny you. Because we're our worst enemy. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 12. Therefore, would you read it with me? Since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away. But their what? Their minds were blinded. For until this day, that same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament because the veil is taken away in Christ. This veil is called the veil of sin. It's called the what? A veil of sin. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the what? Spirit. He's the what? Spirit. Is he the Holy Spirit? Yes. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's what? Liberty or what? Freedom. But we all with what? Unveiled face, beholding in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being what? Transformed, that transformation process, into the same image from what? Glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. And we talked about this already because we're going from glory to glory. In other words, experience to experience. Is everybody with me? Again, the veil is sin. Why is it sin? Because in the old covenant, sin was never removed. It was only covered. Is everybody with me? It was only covered by what? Animal sacrifice. Because the Holy Spirit had not been released to mankind. Is everybody all right? So there was actually no conviction to mankind. There was no conviction. But now there is conviction because the Holy Spirit has been released to all mankind. Man has no excuse. None. Is everybody okay? It's called the veil of sin. Why? See, sin, even after a person becomes a believer, sin is what begins to blind again. Touching unclean things begin to blind again. Living for yourself begins to blind again. In John 16. Transformation process. What are being transferred more and more to his image and likeness till there's actually a transfiguration. John 16, in verse 5, please. Whew. Lift your hands to heaven and thank Jesus for the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Regeneration of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. See, nobody has excuse now. There isn't a human being in this realm that has an excuse. Not one. Verse 5. Let's speak it. But now I go away to him who sent me, and none of you ask me, where are you going? And Jesus said, because I have said these things, you sorrow. You have filled your hearts with sorrow. Verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. Why? Because while Jesus was here, he could only cover those. He didn't live in them yet. Only by the Holy Spirit can Jesus live in me and you. Verse 8. And when he has come, he will what? Come on, read it with me. He will what? Convict. Why? Because conviction wasn't until the Holy Spirit had come. He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. And of sin because they do not follow me or believe me. Of judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have what? Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Sorry. Of judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot what? Bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine, and he will declare it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore, I said that he will take of mine and declare it to you. A little while and you will not see me. And again, a little while and you will see me. Because I go to the what? To the Father. This is so profound. Again, he talks about the conviction when the Holy Spirit will be released to all mankind. But first, there must be something. There must be the shedding of the blood of Christ. There must be the shedding of the blood of the Creator of all mankind who was in Jesus, which would cleanse the way for conviction to be released to man. The Holy Spirit. Why? Because he's the one that is working on the transformation so that we can be transfigurated. Is everybody with me? From transformation to transfiguration. He's fulfilling the guidance of all truth and abundant life that Jesus wants me and you to have, which is the wonderful riches of knowing him and the glory of knowing him. Is everybody okay? Remember, the world is ruled by deception and fear. The world is ruled by deception and fear. The first thing the Holy Spirit starts to deal with me and you is in dissolving the human nature and the access of fear to our lives. He begins to dissolve our human nature. That's his purpose. If we what? Let him. If we what? Let him. That's called surrender. Remember, one of the keys to victory is cooperation. Is everybody okay? And Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9 and verse 23. Then he said to them all, if anyone what? Desires. Again, you must have a desire. If you don't have a desire to follow Jesus, you're not his. You're not his. If anyone desires to come after me, let him what? Deny himself. Come on, speak it. Take up his cross and follow me. Whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and himself is destroyed or lost? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his glory and in his Father's and the holy angel. But I tell you truly, there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. So what's he saying? Deny yourself. Why? Because Jesus is saying, listen, you got to cooperate with the transformation and regeneration of the Holy Spirit, which his first purpose is to begin to dissolve your human nature and any fear that's attached to it. Verse 28. Now it came to pass about 8 days, which days after these sayings, that he took Peter, John, and James, and went up on the mountain to pray. Now, the word here says about 8 days. Everyone say about 8 days. Is that an absolute? No, but the absolute was 6 days because it's out of two witnesses where there's a confirmation, because both other gospels say 6 days because there's a prophetically representation that after 6,000 years, we will be transfigured to those who follow. Is everybody okay? Praise God. Does it mean it lies? No. He said about, didn't he? But in the scriptures, you always know that two always means it's witness. So those are more of an absolute. Is everybody okay? Praise God. So Jesus took these three dudes and they went up to the mountain and prayed in verse 29. And as he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered, and his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men talked with him who were Moses and Elijah, which will be the two witnesses that will come. And they will be witnesses in Jerusalem. Then there'll be 144,000 witnesses all over the world, which is associated with the 12 tribes of Israel. And they will be witnessing all over the world. And then after 3.5 years, or actually 3.5 days, they will be taken up. And that's associated with me and you. After tribulation of 3.5 years, we will be taken up. But anyways, let's go a little further here. Verse 30. And behold, two men talk with him, who were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. Hallelujah. Some people are going to be asleep when there's a transfiguration, and they're going to miss the bus out. And they were fully awake. They saw his glory and two men who stood with him. Then it happened as they were parting from him that Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here, and let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah, not knowing what he had said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud. A voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. When the voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone, but they kept quiet and told no one in those days any of the things that they had seen. Why? They probably would have thought they were nuts. Is everybody with me? In other words, what was Jesus explaining? Look at He's saying here, in denying ourselves, that's one of the first things the Holy Spirit begins to deal with us, in dissolving the human nature and those things that are attached to us of fear. Amen? Not only dissolving, as you die, let me share this, as you die naturally, humanly, carnally, selfishly, from all selfishness, as you die naturally, humanly, carnally, selfishly, to every evil thing, the new life of the Holy Spirit floods in to the transformation until it is completely complete for transfiguration. Is everybody with me? So there is a process, isn't there? And you and I have a choice to allow the Holy Spirit to bring us into this process and to constantly be led or not. God will never interfere with your free will. Amen? So in this, as we continue to deny and die to our natural state, human state, carnal, selfish state of being, to every evil thing, the new life of the Holy Spirit comes and floods in so that he can continue to create in me and you and bring us through the process of transformation till it is complete for transfiguration. Is everybody okay? Matthew 26. Matthew 26. Transformation process. We're being transformed to transfiguration. Matthew 26. And verse 6. So can we do it without the Holy Spirit? No way. That's why he was sent. Oh, glory. Let's speak it together. 26:6. And when Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil. And she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste?" They were, remember, they did not have the Holy Spirit. "For this fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor." But when Jesus was aware of it, he said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a good work for me. For you have the poor with you always, but me you do not have always. For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, she did it for my what? Burial." What was the key? You can't die without the anointing. That's one of the functions of the Holy Spirit, is to cause you to die to all of your nature, your natural human. He wants to dissolve your human state of being so that the divine nature can have control. Because when the divine nature is in control, the Holy Spirit is in control. "Assuredly, I say to you, whether this gospel, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her." Does everybody get it? Powerful. So the anointing of the Holy Spirit will keep the human nature in a dissolving state of being. If you what? Cooperate. Everything's associated with cooperation. If you're not willing to cooperate, what happens? Your growth stops. A limitation is placed on you by the enemy. Galatians chapter 2. We are in a serious time. Why? There's more evil, isn't there? Things are getting worse out there. They're not getting better. But praise be to God that those who are in the kingdom under the anointing, things are getting better. But those who are not, things are tough. Glory. I love glory. Galatians chapter 2. Is everybody there? In verse 17, please. But if while we seek to be what? Justified by Christ, we ourselves are found sinners. Is Christ therefore a minister of sin? Certainly not. For if I build again those things which I destroyed, I make myself a what? Transgressor. In other words, the things that the Lord has delivered you from, obviously, what happens is an individual begins to build on those. He begins to rely on those things that he was delivered from. Now that becomes sin. And what begins to happen until there's repentance or turn away from it, the veil comes back. Verse 19. For through the law died, died to the law that I might live to who? God. Listen, read this. Speak it out. I have been what? Crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh or in the natural, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. In other words, the law exposed sin, but could never remove it. It exposed it, but could never remove it. Christ removed it, released his Holy Spirit, so his sons and daughters would be led. Now, I want you to understand something. Children are not led. What are children? Rebellious. Does everybody get it? That's why the Bible says those who are led are called sons of God. So know that an individual that is immature, childlike, cannot be led. Why? Always rejects what the Holy Spirit will say anyways. There are people who have been saying they've been walking with the Lord 30 years and are still never led. And they never will be led till the day they die. Until they come to a place where they have a willing desire to allow the Holy Spirit to lead them. Again, that must be a willing desire and a choice. And that's just not at our own convenience. It's a part of an everyday life. It is called the life of the Spirit, not called the life of self. Is everybody okay? So, children. I remember Paul was writing the letters, what he called them, babes. He said, you should have been teachers by now, but you're still babes drinking and eating milk instead of meat. Not willing to deny yourself or allowing the Holy Spirit to regenerate, to transform, and prepare you for configuration. Why? Because the veil of sin comes back. Still touching unclean things, doing what individuals want. Is everybody all right? Jude, book of Jude. Book of Jude, in verse 14. Oh, hallelujah. Let's speak it. Now, Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men also, saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000 of his saints to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly, among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have committed in an ungodly way, of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are what? Grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lust. They mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how they told you that there would be what? mockers in the last time, who would walk according to their own ungodly lust. These are sensual persons who cause division, not having the Holy Spirit. Not having the Holy Spirit. They speak evil dignitaries and things because they have no understanding, because they don't have the Holy Spirit. It's amazing how many people always come against tongues when they don't even have tongues. That ain't God. Well, you're an idiot. Go get filled with the Holy Spirit and then come back and talk to me. Verse 20. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your what? Most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Hello, that means tongues. Does everybody get it? Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And on some have compassion and making a distinction, but on others slapping the head. But on others, save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. Now to him who's able to keep you from stumbling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty and dominion and power both now and forever. Amen. Remember, Jesus is the Holy Spirit now. Amen? He is the Holy Spirit. Not having the Spirit. If the anointing of the Holy Spirit is not taught, preached, or sought, he's not in these places. If the Holy Spirit is not sung, he's not in places. Does everybody get it? Why? Because he must be invited. He's always invited. He isn't there. Why? Because people aren't willing to receive. Again, there must be a willing heart to deny yourself and allow the Holy Spirit to truly take over. Not just once or when you feel like it. It is a life of it. It is a life that's called the life of the Spirit, not the life of John Doe. Amen? Or Mary Doe. Romans 7. Therefore, my brethren, you also have what? Become dead to the law through the body of Christ, that you may be married to another, to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God. For when we are in the flesh, the sinful passions which were aroused by the law were at work in our members to bear fruit to death. But now we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by, so that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit and not in the oldness of the what? Letter. Wow. Serve in the newness. So serve means to follow. In other words, we are being led by the newness of the Holy Spirit, not according to the old man, but according to the new nature. Acts 17. Acts 17. Everyone say, I want to be led, not misled. You ever have directions and be driving and make a mistake? Man, some of the places we end up could be very strange, man. That's what happens, doesn't it? When we're misled, we end up in... Look at, if there's not peace, joy, and righteousness in that arena, there's definitely misled. If there's not a fruit of righteousness, you're not even his. Acts 17, 22. That's how we know who are his. Those who have the fruit of righteousness. Not how much they preach. Not how much they teach. Not how much materialism they have. Not if they're good people. There must be a fruit of righteousness. That's what determines those are his and who are not. In verse 22, let's speak it. Then Paul stood in the midst of Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious." In other words, you are very deceived. "For as I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' Therefore, to the one whom you worship without knowing, him's the one I'm going to proclaim to you." Because obviously all your little statues over there and icons and all kinds of other things is not my dad. Verse 24. "God who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands or in objects. Nor is he worshipped with man's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord and hope that they might grope for him and what? Find him. Though he is not far from each one of us, for in him we live, move, and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said. For we are what? Also his offspring. Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. Sure, truly, these times of ignorance God has overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to what? Why? Because the Holy Spirit was released to bring conviction. Verse 31, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in what? Righteousness. By the man whom he has ordained, he has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. And of course, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, others said, we will hear you again on this matter later. So Paul departed. Now, this is so profound. Because the divine nature, as we get to the place when we take no thought, everyone say no thought, of ourselves, then God takes thoughts for us. Has everybody got it? When you're in a place where you're not taking thought of your selfishness, when you're into that place where you're not taking thought of yourself first, then he takes the thoughts. Why? Because if you're putting yourself first, you cannot be led. Why? The Holy Spirit brings things to remembrance. That's why Jesus gave us the formula, deny yourself. If you really want to be mine, if you really want to follow me, you're going to have to deny. Why? Because if you can't even fight until you deny yourself first. In other words, you will fight physically and not spiritually unless you deny yourself first. Is everybody okay? As we get to the place where we take no thought of ourselves, then God takes thought for us. The divine nature always precedes divine order, which is a holy order. It is a holy order. He says, be holy because I am holy. 2 Peter chapter 1. The divine nature always precedes divine order, which is a holy order. Does everybody understand that? Because you can't do one without the other, can you? Second Peter chapter 1. Verse 2, 2 Peter. Are you guys there yet? Are you ready? Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, to the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which has been given to us exceedingly and great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For these things are yours and abound. You will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. For an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Powerful. For this reason, I will not be negligent to remind you always of these things, though you know and are established in the present truth. The divine presence, power, and nature, we are his property. We are his property. Does everybody understand it? There's a place where we know that we are his property. That's when you can say, can't touch this. Doo-doo-doo-doo. Amen? Can't touch this. Now, there's an area that we've got to come to understand. Because one of the things that so many people make emotional decisions, and you'll hear this over and over. Emotional decision making is one of the most dangerous things that you and I could do. The Holy Spirit does not bring emotional decisions. You always know that if there's an emotional decision, it's not the Holy Spirit. He brings decisions by truth. That's it. There is no emotion in it. This is it. This is the way it is. And this is what's going to happen. Why? Because emotion causes an individual to disobey. You know, in the military, if you begin to understand, you know, military operations, where they bring people through boot camp, and they don't give a hoot how you feel. In fact, that's one of the things that they're dissolving. See, the Holy Spirit dissolves your human nature in that arena of me, 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 me. Mine, 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 mine. Self, 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 self. Fulfilling of emotion. Fulfilling of emotion. I need to have my emotions filled. Well, nobody told me today that I was a good person. Oh, shut up. Amen. Go get it from the throne room. Amen. He will always encourage you. Well, nobody recognizes me. Oh, shut up. If you're needing to be recognized, you're being puffed up then. Amen? Again, emotional decisions are so dangerous. This is what the Holy Spirit deals with us in the beginning. Why? Because emotional decisions are called fearful also. Decisions made by fear are emotional. Amen? So you're going to have two decisions. It will be a decision that's made by lust, which is desire, overwhelming desire, or a decision made by fear. Amen? Those are two emotional decisions that will come to you always by the enemy. But there's only one decision that is made by truth, And it is guided by the Holy Spirit where you and I are led, not misled. Amen? When people keep saying, well, I feel, well, I feel, well, I feel, that's how they live. Well, no. Out of the heart, the mouth speaks. It exposes yourself. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Psalm 133. Glory. Transformation to configuration. It's a process, isn't there? Is everybody at Psalm 133? Would you read it with me? Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity of the Spirit. Has everybody got it? It is like the precious oil. What's the oil represent? It's symbolic to the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Upon the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edge of his garments. In other words, we are changing conduct, everything. He said, it's like the dew of Hermon descending upon the Mount of Zion. Read this with me. For there the Lord, what? Commanded. Everyone say commanded. Amen. The blessing of life forevermore. Glory. And I'm going to close at 1 Corinthians 15. We must become controlled by the Holy Spirit. Everyone say, I must become controlled by the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, take over. In Jesus' name. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50. Glory, glory, glory. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together, please. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I tell you what? A mystery. I tell you what? Mystery. We're at 1 Corinthians 15, 50. 1. We shall not all what? Sleep, but we shall all be changed, transfigured. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, this mortal has put on immortality. Then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, which who is the anointed one and his anointing. Again, who is the Lord now? The Holy Spirit. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be what? Steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. In the Lord. Your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Means your labor is not in vain in the Spirit. But if it's not done in the Spirit, is it vain? Yes. Nothing that is done. Nothing. Everything, anything that's done without the Spirit is vain. Amen? It's vain. That's why we must be led. So if you don't welcome it in everything you're doing, you won't be led. You'll be misled. And you will not bear the fruit of righteousness. Then you won't be considered his. There's that place. Remember, the Holy Spirit is dissolving the old nature, the carnal, the selfishness, the fear, the emotional decisions, the emotional attachments, the pleasing of man. so that we live a state of being where our only concern is to please Him. That's what we live, living in the Spirit. Amen? That means living in the Spirit is making, acknowledging Him and making your decisions, laboring unto Him in the Spirit. Where He's not welcome, He's not there. Amen? Praise God. Father, we thank You for Your word. We are honored and blessed. I thank You, Lord, that not only has Your seed been imparted, but it's been anointed by Your Holy Spirit. So, Holy Spirit, we ask that You break every yoke of bondage in our lives. Bring conviction, bring counsel, bring chastisement. Bring Your will so that we are no longer misled, but led. And let the seed that's been imparted in us grow and bear fruit for Your glory. Possess us. That is our desire today, Lord, that You possess us by Your Spirit so that we may be well-pleasing to You. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.